Hey, how's it going, everybody? John here, and I'm just going to do a quick unboxing of Thieves Guild. Now, I never owned one of these when I was younger. I was never able to get my hands on one of them, but I remember seeing in Dragon Magazine the advertisements for why play anything but a thief, and it would advertise this. So I don't own one of the, or I've never owned one of these, but as if you know me, you know that I agree. Why play anything but a thief? It's the best character class. So we're going to be taking a peek at what's in here, what it looks like, and all that other kind of stuff. Let's look. Okay, so it actually comes with three booklets. The first one is a basic character creation. This is for the fantasy system in general. And the second one is the Thieves Guild book, which has five chapters in it. And then there's an additional booklet for chapter six, which is Bandit Scenarios and Highwaymen Adventures. Now, this was published in 1984 by Gamelords, and it's what you would expect from a 1984 book. The art is black and white. It would be considered amateur art by today's standards. The layout is also, I mean, it's 1984, so it's two-column white page, easy to read. The font is a little old school, and they're using hyphenation, which always kills me. And they're using perfect. Using justified columns and hyphenation, because that's how computer operation books look. So looking through basic character creation, you have a bunch of races, which people are calling kindred these days. I never liked race. I always rallied against using race. The Tunnels and Trolls actually uses kindred. I like kindred a lot more. Kin, species is something that I've used. In this case, the races are humankind, elves, half-elves, dwarves, hobbits. Those are copyrighted protected terms, sir. Let's see, centauri, which are exactly what you think they are. Pixies, kobolds, orcs. Oh, there's orcs! Orcs possess hypervision, but are otherwise unexceptional in terms of sensory or special abilities. Oh, they use the term Urukai, except they spell it differently. Half-orcs. Half-orcs are the products of orcish-human relations, which usually occur as a result of a forced union. Yeah. Goblins. Avanthari, which are winged people. Krindorians are the spawn of an ancient mating between humans and hill giants. Curiously, those are not forced. I just stumbled on something. HAC0. They have a term called Hacko. Here's the character attributes chart, which tells you what your strength, coordination, reflexes, stamina, intelligence, discretion, talent. Okay, so magnetism and appearance. So coordination is dexterity, reflexes is agility. Discretion is the human character's common sense and ability to intuitively select a proper course of action in an unfamiliar situation. Talent is power in the basic role-playing in the Chaosium system. It's your ability to use magic. Then there's magic resistance, which is different than that. And magnetism, which is charisma. And you roll 3d6 and add your racial bonuses and penalties and things. This is pretty standard stuff. It's old school D&D, except reskinned. But let's get into this book. What kind of fun things does this book have in it? Oh, right off the bat, there's the thief skills. Sense traps, locate traps. Sense traps and locate traps are two different things? Okay. Disarm traps. Pick locks, pickpocket, silent motion, hide and cover, climb, spot, hidden, sense, ambush. Okay. Pretty standard stuff. Looks like they're all percentile based, so you'll be rolling a d20 to hit. you'll be rolling a different kind of die for your saving throws, and you'll be rolling percentile dice for your thieving skills. So all over the map. And then it's got a ton of systems for pickpocketing, like if you get detected, if people see you. So there's a mechanic for if you successfully pickpocket someone, that doesn't mean that nobody sees you. So you have to check to see if somebody sees you. Is that an extra step? Probably, because as a GM, I could interpret failure as you did pick the pocket successfully, but somebody else saw you. And most of this is really straightforward. It's a percentile roll. Did you succeed? Did you not succeed? Which is one of the things I really like about basic role-playing from Chaosium, is you succeed or you fail, and you roll a you roll percentile dice, and you know immediately. It's like, I have a 75% chance of succeeding. You know, and these days, the new Call of Cthulhu and the new RuneQuest, they have degrees of success built into the system, which also makes it fun for the GM and players, too. So they also added a whole mechanical system, a whole, not just a mechanic, but a system for tailing people, which I'm not sure I would use, but I like the idea of pointing out these are tropes in a thief game. Tailing people is a trope in the thief game, so we should have a mechanic for it. I don't know if I would have an entire system for trailing, but the idea of, but I like the idea of saying trailing. Yeah, this is following people around the city without getting lost. That's something that you do in a thief game, so here it is. Again, another thing, disguising. It's a trope in a thief game. You disguise yourself as something to get by guards. There's a mechanic for it. I like how your appearance rating, the more middling it is, the easier it is for you to disguise yourself because you're more of a blank slate, but the more traditionally unattractive you are or the more traditionally attractive you are, the harder it is to disguise yourself because, well, you're so distinct. And it has things for if you're disguising yourself as a different gender, if you're disguising yourself as a different race, those things also come into play too. Oh, check it out. Audience IQ. Add or subtract 5% for each point of difference between the IQ of the thief attempting to disguise and the IQ of the individual or individuals to whom the disguise is being presented. That's cute. There's a little thing here called the role of magic. The fantasy system rules for designing wizards and arcane artifacts are presented in Paths of Sorcery, which I believe was never released. I could be wrong about that. A companion volume to this one. Although player characters developed for use with Thieves Guild are not designed to be spellcasters, they may still come into contact with magical enchantments or the mages who create them in a number of ways. And then there's a really quick... And this is it. These are the magic rules right here, which is essentially you get a magic item and it does a thing. I like that. My favorite magic system, I've said this before, is the Pendragon magic system, which is you're a knight, you're not Merlin, you don't use magic. Get over it. But for this, I really like this because you're a thief. Magic should be this foreign alien thing. It should be something that you don't have, that you have to deal with. And it's something that there isn't really, I mean, they do have a couple of mechanics here, but it's something that you don't have mechanics for, because if you have mechanics for it, then the players know how it works, right? If I have to make a saving throw to use spells, players know that. They know that, you know, I have to make a saving throw to use spells, blah, blah, blah. If they don't know how magic works because there's no rules for it, it's strange and bizarre and weird, even to the players. And for that, I like that a lot. Here's other activities, because these shouldn't be, because fencing stolen goods isn't under things like tailing. Okay. Okay, so this is really, really cool. Simulating the medieval justice system. Gotcha, thief. What happens when you get caught? Yes, there's a whole system for it. But in this case, it's really cool. Okay, I broke my E-prime rule. I like this a lot. So what you do is you got a whole bunch of different kinds of judges. You have the strict judge, the fair judge, the bleeding heart judge, the hanging judge, the sadistic judge, the greedy judge. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's 6 of them. You can roll a d6 to see which one you get. And then you roll percentile dice to see what their judgment is when you get caught and you have a trial. It includes death, death, mutilation, prison, fine, and acquitted. And the higher you roll, the better the result, well, at least for you, because you want acquitted. You want that one, right? And so what you do is that you can bribe the judge. And bribing the judge, you roll on the table for how much the judge wants to be bribed. And there's a minimum bribe, and that is how much you roll. So by the minimum, if the minimum bribe required by a judge is paid, the player may add a D4 times 5 to his trial result roll. There's also some judges will have a bad reaction to any defendant who appears to be a member of the local Thieves Guild. So you can check to see what attitude your judge had toward the Thieves Guild. And, oh, check it out. There's NPC judges. They have a whole list of NPC judges. Heinrich the Hangman, Maximum John Sirka. So I could see me making my own judges with their own personal roles for, you know, how they feel about certain things. And there's a bit about lawyers, too. And one of the other things in here is reputation, which is a stat. And it's a mechanic where your reputation goes up and down based on the things you do. And your reputation can affect how the judge looks at you. So there's that. And then finally, at the very end, there's the most important thing, which is the name of the game, which is all about Thieves Guilds. It talks about what a Thieves Guild will and will not do. How it will and will not protect its members. And guild, a little bit about guild structure, the difference between a strong guild, a weak guild, rival guilds, splintered guilds. And there's really only two, is it two? Yeah, there's only two tables in this section, which again, the closer you get to back to the book, the end of the book, the more you get the hand-wavy stuff, which tends to be the good stuff. It's strange, because everyone's so concerned about how much damage a short sword does versus a crossbow, because that's important. But the actual Thieves Guild itself, yeah, we'll just put that at the end of the book. But it does have some really good advice for doing a Thieves Guild. And I just wish it was a little bit meatier. And then here's Chapter 6, which is Bandit Scenarios and Highwaymen Adventures. At first I thought, certainly this whole... How many pages is this? This is 32 pages. This can't be entirely Bandit Scenarios and Highwaymen Adventures. This must be more things. So, essentially, these are people that you can rob. So, there's fur trappers, the coppersmith, the jewel speculator, escaped prisoners. That's a great story. You come across a bunch of escaped prisoners. The Royal Herald, beggars, Jirok. What the hell is Jirok? A massive sandy-haired human walks alone down the road. Rock is an 8th level fighter, an orphan who is ranged in the wilderness by bears. So yeah, he's somebody that play. They're like, oh look, he doesn't have any weapons on him. He's worried by bears, pal. He's gonna mess you up. And again, this is a whole bunch of people that you can run into on the road as you try to rob them because you're a highwayman. Okay, here's chapter 7. Cat burglary scenarios and second story adventures. So this whole thing is essentially things that you can run into. There's Life Along the Street of Silk Veils, which of course is the fun part of the city. Oh, check it out. Is this supposed to be here? Oh, okay, cool. This wasn't, yeah. Maps. Gamers love maps. I am a gamer. There's a little fold-out pamphlet with The Street of Silk Veils, that's cool. Helgors, The Silver Trumpet, sample setting for Highwaymen Encounters, and The Free City of Haven, which I know was an actual box set, which I don't have, but I will soon. This is the meat. This is the stuff that you actually use. This is the stuff as a GM I would go through and I'd pull adventure ideas out and mix and match them, and or sometimes use them straight. But yeah, this is the hefty, this is the best part of the... This is the best part of the box right here. And that's what I got in my copy of Thieves Guild. There may have been more things, but this is what I got in my copy. Maybe there was a character sheet in there. Don't know. If there was, leave a comment below and let me know if I'm missing anything from my copy. But why play anything but a thief? I finally got it after 40 years. But again, the system I'm not going to use. Let's be honest; it's antiquated. It's cumbersome for the purpose of being cumbersome, but that judge's thing is just too cool, and the adventures are going to be really handy when I run my own thief game. So that's what's in the Thieves Guild. Is it worth it for you to shell out $100+ for it? That's entirely up to you. For me, it is, because it's something I always wanted when I was a kid and I was never able to get, and now I have it, so it's worth it to me. But those adventures in the back, those are going to be really handy to me. So, yeah. But nostalgia-wise, I'm glad I got it. So in the comments, leave me notes and things about the thing that you saw when you were a young gamer that you never got a chance to get a hold of and is now out of print and ridiculously expensive. Let me know in the comments below. And until then, I'll be running my Thieves game. I'll talk more about that later. But until then, hey, wear a mask, get vaccinated, take care of each other, and watch your pockets. Thieves. They're everywhere.